Hello students, so once we understand how exactly we can construct and interpret the time temperature transformation curve and a continuous cooling transformation curve, so we are moving on to a important topic in the module number 3, that is a heat treatment of ferrous and non-ferrous materials. Okay, so here heat treatment, the word may look new to you people, but we have seen these activities in a day-to-day life. The best one is cooking the food. Okay, say for example, we are going to take a raw rice, okay, and we are going to put it in the water. Okay, and you just imagine we are going to take it in a open vessel and you are going to take it in a pressure cooker. Okay, so the quality of rice which you are going to get in an open vessel and a pressure cooker is totally different. Okay, so means once you are going to choose a particular temperature and a particular time, okay, the quality of the rice after boiling will be totally different. Means the eating cycle which you are going to select and the cooling. Say now you have kept it in the pressure cooker and you are going to have it only one whistle, and you are not going to allow that one to cool. You are going to just after one whistle, you are going to switch off the stove and you are going to take it away and you are going to open the pressure cooker. Okay, now see the quality of the rice, and in the second instance you just leave that cooker to cool by its own. Okay, so once the whistle gets off, you open the pressure cooker and see the quality of the rice. Means you can see here, okay, so you can observe the things, see the temperature at which you have cooked the rice and the time which you have given to cool that one to the room temperature. So all these things matters on the quality of the cooked rice which you are going to get. Okay, so similarly, okay, so the scientists have observed the change in the properties of these metals or materials, so when they are subjected to the different temperature for a different time. Okay, so that is what normally we are going to call that as a heat treatment. Heat treatment means the materials are subjected to different levels of heat for a definite period of a time to change their property. Okay, so similarly you can take an example. The best example is the bakery items. Okay, so where they are baked at a different temperature for a different intervals of a time. Okay, the bread which you are going to prepare with the help of a maida and a yeast. Okay, so you are going to give a particular shape to that one, and you are going to bake that one in a particular temperature for a particular time. So if you are not going to maintain that temperature and a time, okay, the taste and the smoothness of that bread which you are going to get will be altered. Okay, which will be altered means see, even in the metals they are with their own property. When they are extracted and when they are purified to a particular metal, okay, so they are having their own property. But in the practical reality, okay, so the properties which they have, okay, by birth will not be applicable in the real conditions. So we need to alter those property according to the practical conditions. Okay, so by this method, okay, that is a heat treatment method, so we can alter the property, or we can say in other words, tailor the property according to the practical situation. Okay, so that is what is a e treatment. So in the e treatment, so we are going to get a many types. Okay, so depending upon what properties we want to tailor, okay, and we have a few steps to follow in each and every method. The only one very important thing in the e treatment is so we need to get a single solid phase. A single solid phase. So we have discussed the iron carbon diagram, and we have discussed what are these triple T diagram and a CCT diagram. So when we look into that one, so eutectoid mixture, okay, so eutectoid reaction, where we say solid 1 gives rise to the solid 2 plus solid 3, okay, so is the one region, so where this E treatment is applicable for steels. Okay, when you look into the whole iron carbon diagram, that is the only region, so where you are going to get a single solid phase. Okay, so moving on with that one, so we'll understand now. Okay, so what is the exactly a e treatment, what are the procedures involved in that one, okay, so what are the different types, and how one can tailor the property depending upon the real application. So this one already we have seen it in the module number 2. Okay, so the relationship between a structure, property and performance. Okay, so the basic structure, whatever the material is having, okay, so on that structure the properties are dependent. Okay, so even so when these properties are dependent on the crystal structure, what the material is having. Okay, and while choosing a material for a particular application, so we are going to look into the properties. Okay, so these properties are going to define the performance of that material in a practical application. Okay, means anyone want to change its performance, they need to go back to the property. Okay, so they want to change the property, one has to go back to the structure. Means here the E treatment allows one to change its property by changing its structure. Okay, so how exactly we are going to change the structure? So by changing its the method in which we are going to process that one. Okay, so means E treatment is a secondary process parameter, so where we are going to alter the property by altering its structure. So as we see here, so as we have told in the earlier also, so the E treatment will give an opportunity to alter the properties of the alloys as well as the metals. Okay, so even the composition, so which is present in that one, and the solidification process which we are going to have it, as we have discussed in the module number 2, and the E treatment which we carry in order to alter the property, so all these things will change the structure. So in turn, the change in the structure will lead to the change in the properties and to the performance of the metal. Okay, so moving on, so what exactly a E treatment? Okay, so what normally we can understand here is so E treatment is a combination of heating and cooling operations. Okay, so as I gave an example of cooking a rice in a pressure cooker, so if you open the pressure cooker, so once we get the visual, so the quality will be different, and if you leave that pressure cooker to cool to the room temperature, then the quality will be different. So like that. Okay, so it is what are the temperature, okay, to which you are going to heat that one, and what are the methods you adapt in order to cool that one to the room temperature. Okay, so we'll carry out on a metal or an alloy in the solid state, that is what I said. So we need to have one single solid phase in order to have the heat treatment. Okay, so it has to produce a particular microstructure and hence a desired property. Means E treatment is a combination of heating and cooling operations carried out on a metal or an alloy in a solid state so as to produce. So very important thing to be here noted is a solid state.
Okay, so we are not heating any of the metal or any of the alloy to the molten state. Okay, so we are keeping in the solid state and in a single phase material, in a single phase. So as already I said, so if you see the iron carbon diagram, okay, so austenite is the only one region where you are going to get a single solid phase. So means when we talk about a heat treatment of a steel, so we are going to heat the steel into the austenitic condition, then we are going to carry out a different heat treatment process in order to get a different structures. So what are the different steps we are going to follow in the heat treatment? So we'll see one by one. So now once we know what exactly heat treatment, so heat treatment is a combination of a heating and cooling, okay, methods. So what are the objectives? So why we are doing the heat treatment to metals and alloys? Okay, yes, it is to alter the properties, okay, which makes it to applicable in the real conditions. But in particular, so what are the changes normally we are going to get? Okay, so we can see it here. So first and foremost thing, to increase the strength, okay, increase the strength or a hardness and a wear resistance. Okay, so means so increasing the strength will lead to the hardness, so hardness will lead to the wear resistance. So means all these three properties are dependent on each other. Okay, so when we are going to increase these things, so what are the methods? Okay, what are the different types of heat treatment normally which leads to these properties are bulk hardening and surface hardening. So what are these bulk hardening and surface hardening? So we'll see when it comes to the classification of the heat treatments. So next, to increase the ductility and softness, you can see it here, strength, hardness and wear resistance will fall in one category. So increase ductility and softness. So as already, if you remember, whatever the things we discussed in the module number 1 and 2, okay, so means, so when you want the strength and the hardness, you need to compromise with the ductility. And when you want the ductility, you need to get compromise with the strength and the hardness. Okay, so here, to increase the ductility and the softness, so we can go with the tempering. So tempering normally we call as a secondary heat treatment method. Okay, so what is that one? We'll see. And recrystallization annealing. Okay, so next, to increase the toughness. Toughness means absorbing the energy, so when a load is applied. Okay, so it is again by tempering and recrystallization annealing. So whenever we say material is of a very ductile material, so it is in a position to absorb more energy, so the toughness will be more. To obtain a fine grain size, again very important thing. Okay, so only what we said, the modules are kept in a such a way that so there is a proper interrelation between each module. So we have seen it in the module number 1, where increasing the strength is by decreasing the grind size. Okay, that is the Allpitch equation, which gives the relationship between the grind size and the strength. So to have a good strength in the material, the fine grind, the grind size should be very very small. Means so there will be more number of obstacles. These grind boundaries are going to act as a obstacle to the movement of the dislocation, thereby increasing the strength of the material. So that is obtained by recrystallization, full annealing and normalizing. Okay, so next is to remove internal stresses induced by differential deformation by cold working or maybe during casting. Okay, so all these are maybe by welding. So wherever a material is cooled, okay, uniformly, so if the material is cooled uniformly, then there will be existence of internal stresses. That is the existence of internal stresses. So in order to relieve these things, so we'll go with the stress relief annealing. Okay, so next, so we need to improve the machinability. Say for example, few materials will be having a very good strength and the hardness, but the machinability of those materials will not be that much high. Okay, so in order to increase, okay, machinability means the age
by which a material or a metal or an alloy can be machined using a different machining operations. Okay, so to in order to increase the machinability, so we go with the full annealing and normalizing. Full annealing and normalizing. Next, to improve cutting properties of a tool steel, means the tools should be much higher or harder than the metals which we normally machine. Okay, so in order to have that one, they should be good hard. The cutting tool should be hard enough. So we go with the hardening and tempering to improve surface property. Okay, so maybe to increase the surface hardness. Okay, so which leads to the wear resistance. So then we go with the surface hardening, corrosion resistance. Okay, where the surface is exposed to the environment. Okay, where it should have a high corrosion resistance. Okay, or a very good corrosion resistance. So there also, so we go with the improving the surface property. To improve electrical property, so we go with the recrystallization, tempering, and edge hardening. And to improve magnetic property, hardening and phase transformation. These last two, that is electrical and magnetic property, are highly dependent on the structure of the material. Okay, so in order to change the structure, so we go with the recrystallization. Okay, so there will be a formation of a new crystals in the material, and there should be a phase transformation. So as we have discussed, the different allotropic forms of iron, where changing the structure will change the magnetic property of the material. Changing the phase will change the magnetic properties of the material. So we need to have a phase transformation in order to have the different magnetic properties in the material. Okay, so these are the objectives. So by keeping in these things, so one can choose different types of heat treatment. So what are these different types of heat treatment? So we'll see one by one. So now, in general, so what are the methods we are going to follow it in the heat treatment? Okay, so we have a number of method classification in the heat treatment, but in general, okay, for all the types of heat treatment, so we have a few general steps which we need to follow. So one is, as already we have known, heating metal or alloy in a prescribed temperature. Okay, so we need to heat the metal or the alloy to a particular temperature. Okay, where we are going to get a single phase, single solid phase, single solid phase. That is the first one. Okay, so holding the specimen, the second step will be holding the specimen at that temperature for a known period time. Okay, so this period is known as a holding time or a soaking time. So means here, so our intention is to get a uniform temperature throughout the specimen. Say for example, if you have a rectangular specimen, so if you check the temperature, okay, at any point within or outside that specimen, the temperature should remain same. Okay, so means we need to get a same temperature throughout the specimen. So that is what holding time or a soaking time. So this purely depends on the size and the shape of the specimen. So if it is a complex shape, it is difficult to get a uniform temperature. So we need to wait for a long time in order to get a uniform temperature. And if it is a regular structure, so then it is a very simple to get a uniform temperature. Then the holding or a soaking time will be smaller or maybe lower compared to those things. Okay, so first is choosing the temperature. So next is holding that specimen at that temperature for a particular time. Okay, so this temperature we are going to call as for steels, we call it as a austenizing temperature. Okay, so this is what you call as getting a homogeneous mixture. The last one is cooling at a rate necessary to obtain specific microstructure. Means so if you are going to cool in a different intervals, okay, in a different intervals and in a different mediums, the structure which you are going to get will be totally different. So as we have discussed in a triple T curve, that is a time temperature transformation curve, so we have seen, so if you are going to cool that one okay, in a different interval of time and in different cooling mediums. So what are the structures which you are going to get and what are the properties which you are going to get depending upon those phases. Okay, so in general, so we will follow these three steps, in the heat treatment. First is a heating to a particular temperature, so where we will get a single solid phase. Second thing, holding that specimen at that temperature for a long time, that is a, for a holding time. It depends on the structure or a shape of the specimen. And the third thing is a cooling at the necessary cooling rate depending upon the structure which is required in. Okay, so pictorially we can say like so loading the specimen in a furnace. Okay, so before loading we need to clean the surface. Okay, the surface of the specimen should be free from the grease or maybe the oils. Okay, so it should be cleaned. Okay, then it is heated. Okay, it is heated in the furnace, then it is transferred to the any medium. Okay, that is a cooling medium. And as I said, this tempering and surface coating are a secondary heat treatment methods. Okay, so then we are going to unload that one. So these three are important. So one is selecting a particular temperature, okay, heating the specimen to that temperature, then cooling the medium. Okay, so this tempering and surface coating, so will depends whether it is required by the application or not. Okay, now when we see, okay, so what are the steps in that one and all, so now we'll see how exactly we're going to classify the heat treatment. Okay, so when a metal or an alloy is heat treated, okay, the entire volume is altered. As I said, the holding time and the temperature is dependent on the size of the specimen. Okay, so if you want to alter the whole volume of the material, then so we call that one as a full heat treatment. Okay, so if you want to alter the properties of the bulk material, okay, so throughout the specimen, so in and out of that one, so then we call that one as a full heat treatment. But sometimes the application requires, okay, so only to alter the surface properties, okay, not the inside of the specimen. Okay, so for example, only the surface of the specimen is exposed to the atmosphere. Okay, so where the only the surface comes in contact with the atmosphere and it leads to the corrosion. Okay, so at that time what we need to have is we need to have a coating only at the surface in order to prevent it from the corrosion. Okay, so those type of heat treatment we call as a surface heat treatment. Okay, so want to change the whole properties. Okay, so then we go with the full heat treatment, or we can say mechanical property. In order to change the mechanical properties of the entire material, so we go with the full heat treatment. So if you want to change only the outer surface, so as I gave an example, okay, only the outer surface, then we go with the surface heat treatment. Okay, so if you look into again in general, okay, so what are the different types in the full heat treatment? So we can say one is annealing, so one is normalizing, one is hardening, and one is tempering. And if you want to see that one with the block diagram where we are going to say in the branching, so we have two classification in the heat treatment. Okay, so one is bulk and one is surface. Okay, so bulk is the one where the entire volume of the specimen, okay, so is altered, and surface is the one where only the surface of the specimen is altered. The properties at the surface are altered. So in the bulk we are going to have a three classification. So one is annealing. Okay, so in the annealing, so we are going to have full annealing. Okay, so recrystallization annealing, stress relief annealing, and sporidoid annealing. Okay, so in the next one we are going to have a normalizing. So in the next one we are going to have a hardening and a tempering. Okay, so means so what the property you want at the end of the heat treatment, so depending upon that one, so we can choose either annealing, normalizing, or hardening. again in the annealing. So in particular, what type of property which you want at the end, so we can get a full recrystallization, stress relief and sporidoise. And hardening and tempering, so as I said, so tempering will be the secondary heat treatment process, so where we are going to have two types, mud tempering and harsh tempering. Okay, so you want to get only the ductility, then we go with the harsh tempering. Want to get only the hardness and the brittleness, then we go with the mud tempering. Okay, so in the surface, so we have two. Okay, so one as a thermal and one as a thermomechanical. So when we are going to use only the heat to alter the property at the surface, so we call that one as a thermal. So in the thermal, we are going to have a flame hardening, induction hardening, laser hardening and a electron beam hardening. So if you look into the words, okay, flame, induction, a laser, electron, the medium which you are going to use to heat that specimen, okay, so depending upon that one, we classify them into flame hardening, where we use the oxyacetylene flame, induction hardening, where we use the electric current, laser beam, okay, so where we are going to use a laser technology to heat the specimen, and electron beam, where we are going to bombard the surface with the electron, fast moving electron, to heat up the surface. Okay, and the last category is a thermomechanical. Thermomechanical means a heat as well as a chemical. Okay, heat as well as a chemical. So in this one, we are going to have a carburizing, okay, so nitriding and a carbonitriding. So carburizing, where we are going to inject the carbon atoms to increase the hardness at the surface. Nitriding, where we are going to inject the nitrogen particles or atoms at the surface in order to increase the hardness of a material at the surface. Or carbonitriding, where we are going to have both carbon as well as a nitrogen, so in order to increase the surface hardness. Okay, so these are the classification. So, and these are the things what we are going to discuss in the heat treatment. Okay, so bulk and a surface, and in the bulk few categories, and in the surface a few categories, where exactly we can discuss the things. Okay, so moving on with that, so we'll take up these, whatever the things we have seen it in the previous slide is for a ferrous metals and a ferrous metals and a alloys. And for a non-ferrous alloys, so there are only three things. One is age hardening, annealing and a dispersion hardening. So what are those things? We'll see one by one in order to understand the thing. Okay, so now moving on, in order to understand, okay, so what exactly a heat treatment for a steels, what exactly a heat treatment for a steels, so one need to understand the terminology we are going to use during the process. Okay, so here the important temperature or important region which we are going to concentrate for steels is a eutectoid reaction. Eutectoid reaction, as I said, it occurs at 0.8% of carbon and 727 degree Celsius. Okay, so above 727 degree Celsius, you can see gamma, that is austenite, is the only a single phase mixture which is present at that moment. Means want to have a heat treatment for a steels, so the steel should be heated above 727 to get gamma, that is austenitic phase. Okay, so here we can say ACM, that is a cementoid line. Okay, so you can see the ACM here. Okay, so when you're going to heat this one above 727 till 1147 degree Celsius, so whatever the things will be or the phases will get transferred to the austenite. So only ACM. Okay, so here the A stands for arrest, that is a temperature where we are going to get a different phase transformation. So first line is the ACM. ACM will come to the right side. So where once the temperature crosses this one, so the whatever the cementite which is present will be transferred to the austenite. Okay, you can say like a Chafgug means heating and R means cooling. Okay, so refroidissement. Okay, so which means cooling. So ACM. Okay, so then A0, a subcritical temperature or a Curie temperature, okay, where a cementite will be stable
above that temperature, 210 degrees Celsius. Okay, so below that one, it will not be stable and it will dissociate into the free carbon. Okay, so the next two temperature are A1 and A2. So A1 we call as a lower critical temperature or eutectoid temperature, which is a 727. And A2 is a Curie temperature of a ferrite. It comes in between 768 to the 770. 768 to the 770. So it is almost same as A1 and A2 lines. Okay, so this is a very important one. So once this, whatever the phases which are present, once it crosses this 727 degrees Celsius, so it starts transforming into the austenite during heating. During heating and during cooling, whatever the phases which are present above this line starts transforming into the alpha ferrite and cementite. Alpha ferrite and cementite. So during cooling, okay. So the next temperature is A3, that is a upper critical temperature. Upper critical temperature means so during heating above this line, okay. So whatever the phases which are present will get transferred to the gamma austenite, will get transferred to the gamma austenite during cooling. So once it crosses this line, so this gamma austenite starts transforming into the alpha ferrite. Alpha ferrite. So one has to understand these temperature in order to understand what exactly the process of heat treatment for steels. Okay, so one is a A1, that is a lower critical temperature, that is 727, and A3, that is upper critical temperature, okay, towards the left, and ACM towards the right, so where it gives to the formation of a cementite. Cementite, okay. So next, A4 and A5 are the temperature which are leads to the eutectic and peritectic mixtures. Eutectic and peritectic mixture, okay. So 1148 is the line where we are going to get a eutectic mixture, okay. So 1495 is the line where we are going to get a peritectic reactions. Okay, so moving on with that, so we'll take the first step or the first method in the e-treatment is the annealing. Okay, so annealing involves heating the specimen to a prescribed temperature, so holding at that temperature, then cooling down to the room temperature in a suitable slow rate. So as I said, so when we say heat treatment, you need to remember the three steps. One is heating to a particular temperature, that is above A1 critical temperature, and the second one is holding that specimen at that temperature until you get a constant temperature throughout the specimen. That is the second step. And the third step is cooling. Okay, which method you adapt in order to cool that one to the room temperature. Okay, so when it comes to the annealing, what are the objective normally we find is reducing the hardness or increasing the ductility. So improve machinability and improve toughness. Okay, so you can keep in mind like the annealing is meant in order to increase the ductility of a material. Okay, in turn it increases the machinability as well as the toughness of the material. Okay, and once we look into the annealing, okay, so when we have a different types of annealing, so we can write like this. Okay, so we have a three types here. One is a full annealing, where you can see the A3 line, okay, which lies above 727 till 910 degrees Celsius, and partial annealing will be little bit above 727. Okay, it lies in between A3 and A1, so it is less than 910 and in between 727. And the third is a subcritical annealing. Subcritical annealing means so it is less than 727 degree Celsius. Less than 720 degree Celsius. So subcritical annealing normally is in order to have the stress relief annealing. Okay, or maybe sporadoid annealing, so where only the transformation take place at a temperature which is lower than a critical temperature. So one need to remember these three temperatures. So once we are going to see the different types of annealing.
So this is the eutectoid reaction, okay, in the iron carbon phase diagram. So just we have taken it out in order to understand the single phase solid phase, that is a gamma austenite. So this is the A3 line, this is the A1 line 727 and this is the ACM line. So from now onwards we are going to indicate or refer to these lines in order to define the various types of heat treatment processes. Okay, so A1 727, so A3 727 to 912 and ACM 727 till 1148 degree Celsius. Okay, so eutectoid mixture, so which normally consider for a heat treatment of a steel. Okay, so here when it comes to the types of annealing, the first one is a recrystallization annealing. Okay, so recrystallization means there is a formation of a new crystals within the already existing crystals. Okay, the purpose which we are going to do or carry out this recrystallization annealing is to improve the ductility or to improve the strain hardening. Strain hardening is a it is a strengthening mechanism, okay, by which you are going to increase the strength of the metal also. Okay, the temperature will be above recrystallization temperature, so holding time 2 to 3 minutes per mm thickness. Okay, so cooling type slow cooling, and application, so steel wires and a sheet. Okay, so remember here, annealing is a method where the alloys or a steel alloy is heated above 727 degree Celsius and it is kept at that temperature, okay, to have a uniform temperature throughout the specimen. Then it is cooled in the furnace itself. It is cooled in the furnace itself by switching off the furnace. Okay, so we are going to allow the specimen to cool to the room temperature. So allowing it to be in the furnace by in the off condition. Okay, so it takes a long time in order to get cooled to the room temperature. Okay, so now when you see the second type in the full annealing, the purpose to remove internal stresses to improve the ductility. So the temperature range we are going to use is above A3. Okay, so above A3 it will be around 940 to 960 degree Celsius. So holding time, as already said, it is depends on the size and shape of the specimen. And a cooling rate, so it is kept it in the furnace. So application, so hypoeutectoid steels. Okay, so when we say A3, so A3 is corresponding to the hypoeutectoid steels. And the disadvantage normally which we are going to get it here will be expensive because of a long cooling cycles. So normally in is annealing, okay, so whenever we opt for annealing, so it is taking a long time to cool to the room temperature. Okay, so little bit expensive. Why? Because again we are going to keep it in the furnace, so we have to wait until the specimen comes to the room temperature, so in order to carry out a secondary heat treatment process. Okay, so it takes a long time. So third one is a partial annealing, so where we are going to use this one to improve the machinability. Okay, so here in order to improve the machinability, we are going to carry out two, okay, that is a primary and a secondary heat treatment. In the step one, so it is heated to 940 to 960 and it is kept at that temperature for a particular long time. Then we are going to cool this one rapidly to below the A1 temperature. Okay, so we are going to heat above A3, then rapidly we'll cool this one to the A1. In the second step, so it is held at a temperature which lies in between 600 to 700. Okay, so where, so austenite becomes a perlite. Okay, so we are going to hold at a temperature which lies between 600 to 700 where the austenite completely transferred to the perlite. So perlite is a ductile in nature. And a cooling type, cooled in air, rate of cooling is not important because once the temperature is below A1, so there will not be any phase transformation. Only the austenite will transfer to the perlite. Okay, so application, so used for alloy steels. Okay, so where there is a need for a ductility. So the fourth category in the annealing is a process or a subcritical or stress relief annealing. Okay, so means we are going to carry out this type of heat treatment to relieve the internal stresses which are developed during a casting or a forging, okay, or a rolling. Okay, so here the temperature range is below A1 critical, that is in between 650 to 700 degree Celsius, and a holding time sufficiently long so that the whole specimen, throughout the specimen, if we are going to get a
a constant temperature. Okay, so cooling type, so not so important because already it is below the A1. Already it is below the A1. So next, the fifth one is the sporadoid annealing. Sporadoid annealing here to improve machinability. Okay, so carried out in a three steps. Okay, normally we are going to have a three steps. So one, the temperature below A1, okay, 650 to 700, okay, and it is slow cooling. Next, the step two will be, so temperature range above and below 727, alternate heating and cooling. So it is like a simultaneously, so we are going to have a heating and cooling, okay, so continuously in order to have the different phases which are going to present in that one. Okay, so means here the structure of these perlite, okay, so will be converted into the sphere like structures. Okay, so these things normally is applied in high carbon steels, okay, tool steels or alloy steels to increase the ductility of the materials. Ductility of the materials means one can choose, okay, out of these 4 to 5 methods in the annealing. So depending upon what is the end requirement, what is the end requirement, whether they want to have only the machinability or whether they want to have only the ductility, okay, so whether they want to have only the stress relief conditions, okay, so or only the strain earning in the material. Okay, so irrespective of any type of annealing, okay, or any type of heat treatment, one has to keep in mind, so we have only three steps. One is to heating temperature, you need to decide depending upon the types of that one. Second, holding at that temperature. Third is a cooling method. So once we understand what exactly annealing, okay, so we'll move on to the second method, okay, in the heat treatment is a normalizing. Okay, so the temperature range normally we choose for normalizing is above A3 and ACM temperature. So we are not going to talk about a A1 temperature, okay, here. So it will be above the A1, okay, and ACM, A3 and ACM, okay, so above which it will be in a gamma, that is a austenitic condition. And so normalizing is cooled in the open air, okay, so as we discussed in the annealing, it is kept in the furnace in off condition to bring it to the room temperature. So here in the normalizing, it is kept it in the open air to bring it to the room temperature. So how exactly we're going to do? So it consists of heating the steels to the 40 to 50 degrees Celsius upper critical temperature. So A3 and ACM are upper critical temperature, and it is held at that temperature for a long time to get a constant temperature throughout the specimen. Then it is cooled to the room temperature in the open air. Okay. So cooling in a still air is faster than the rate of cooling employed in the annealing. That is, the rate at which we cool it in the furnace is much slower compared to the annealing. So in the normalizing, the cooling rate is a bit faster. So in other words, we call this normalizing as a air quenching also. Okay, so it is suddenly cooled in the air, so we use a term called a quenching in the air. Okay, so the type of a structure obtained normalizing will depend largely on the thickness of the cross section. Thin cross section will give a fine grain size, okay, and a thick sections will give a coarser one. Okay, so we are not going to get a uniform grain size in the thicker cross section. The microstructure obtained after normalizing will be a fine perlite. Okay, because the cooling rate is bit faster compared to the annealing, so the grains will not get enough time to grow, okay, for into a coarser grain size. So we'll get a fine grain size in the normalizing. The purpose is to get a harder and a stronger steel. Okay, so if you see the purpose which we discussed for annealing is to have a ductile or maybe machinability or to increase the toughness. But here the normalizing is carried out in order to get a harder and a stronger steel. Okay. So it will improve the machinability, modify and refine cast dendritic structure. Dendritic structure where we are going to have a branch-like structures. So in order to break up that one to the small or a fine grain size, so we go with the normalizing. Okay. So once we see these two processes, okay, so annealing and normalizing. So what are the difference normally we find it for annealing and normalizing? Okay, the first and foremost thing, so the way in which it is cooled. So in the normalizing, it is cooled in open air. In annealing, it is cooled in the furnace itself in a off condition. So in normalizing, we won't get a much time to have a coarser grain, so we'll get a fine perlitic conditions. And in annealing, we'll get a enough time to grow. Okay, so we'll get a coarse and a medium perlite. So normalized steels are harder and annealing are less harder. We are going to get a fine grain size here, so we are going to get a coarser grain size in the annealing. And normalizing is less expensive because it is cooled in the open air. Annealing is more expensive because it is kept it in a furnace to cool to the room temperature. So cooling rates are not critical. Okay, so cooling rates are bit critical here. Okay, so they are bit faster. So improve machinability of a medium carbon steels. So improve machinability of a low carbon steels. So you can see here. So annealing normally carried out for a hypoeutectoid steels. So where the carbon percentage much lesser than 0.8%. But normalizing normally improves the machinability where we are going to get a medium carbon steels. The where the carbon percentage will be little more than 0.8%. Okay. So normalized steels are less ductile. Okay, so compared to the annealing, so where it is more intense to get the ductile materials in the annealing. Okay, so that's how exactly we can see the two types of heat treatment. So to have the different properties at different intervals and depending upon the different cooling mediums also. Okay, so thank you.